This place is fun.
Hello again, August is here, somehow, and you know what that means. That's right, in addition to making me increasingly distraught at how quickly time passes as I grow older, it also means new video games, so let's focus on the positive. Here are August 2023's biggest video game releases. Before we get started, friendly reminder that new games get delayed and announced all the time, and we do our very best for these videos to be timely and accurate, but things fall through the cracks. Last month, I screwed up and forgot about the long-awaited Jagged Alliance 3, thus making my already jagged alliance with you, dear viewers, even more craggy and uneven. In my defense, this PC strategy game was announced all the way back in 2004, and the release date wasn't announced until the night before I wrote the script for last month's episode. How does that excuse my omission? That is a great question. Anyway, on August 2nd, you could reunite with your gigantic twin chrome-plated robot girlfriends when Atomic Heart's Annihilation Instinct DLC drops for the non-Switch consoles and PC. If shooting a bunch of robots in the head isn't the vibe, a day later, Flutter Away lets you shoot a bunch of butterflies in the head with a camera. This game has you playing as a lepidopterologist, aka a butterfly researcher, studying these beautiful and completely harmless insects who only Todd Flanders and Dean Venture and my weird wife are afraid of. You can see these dusty bugs in their natural habitats on the PC and Nintendo Switch. Leaving Steam early access and coming to basically everything on the 3rd as well is Adore. That is a creature collecting action game that is somewhere between Pokemon and Diablo, and its early iterations have had a very positive response since it debuted way back in 2020. Of course, the big game that's dropping on August 3rd that's been in early access since 2020 as well is Baldur's Gate 3. To say this game is long awaited is quite the understatement. Baldur's Gate 2 won IGN's role-playing game of the year back at the turn of the century, which is to say, the year 2000 when I was in 9th grade. This third installment is in the extremely capable hands of Larian Studios, who gave us the Divinity Original Sin games. From what I've seen, Baldur's Gate 3 is aiming to be the most authentic simulation of an actual D&D campaign to date, which means you can do pretty much whatever the hell you want. The trailers so far kind of look like generic high fantasy fare, which is fine, but from the sound of things, your experience could get a lot weirder, like the recent D&D movie, if that's your cup of tea. I totally slept on Divinity Original Sin 2 because the overly serious colon cool sounding title made me want to, well, go to sleep, but my friend told me that you can play as a skeleton who talks to dogs and uses their bony little fingers to pick locks, and sure enough, that is a thing that you can do. In Baldur's Gate 3, they show that you can have sexual relations with your druid friend after he's used magic to turn himself into a bear, much to the horror of any wildlife in the vicinity. D&D should be as weird and as stupid as you want it to be, and it's nice to see a D&D video game able to keep up with that. Baldur's Gate 3 is on PC on the 3rd, PS5 on September 6th, and it's coming to Xbox Series X and S eventually. They're trying to figure out split screen or something. If all of that sounds much too complicated and weird, on August 4th you can play Super Space Club, which is a lo-fi shooter about, you guessed it, shooting stuff in space. That's on PC and the Xboxes. Also on the 4th is Sklash, a 2D samurai fighting game with one-hit kills, which seems kinda like a cross between Bushido Blade and Nidhogg, but the aesthetic reminds me of old Flash browser games that I would've played the shit out of on high school library computers. That's coming to everything. On August 8th, Gord is on New Gen and PC. This is the survival and strategy-based RPG from a bunch of former Witcher 3 devs, and it's pulling from a bunch of Slavic folklore, and it definitely looks like a Gord time. I've been making that joke for 2.5 years. That's on the newer consoles and PC. The free-to-play open-world ARPG Tower of Fantasy, which is already on mobile and PC, comes to PS4 and 5 on the 8th. That same day, you can live out your fantasies of becoming a sports entertainment superstar in WrestleQuest, a retro-styled RPG that has a star-studded roster that should appeal to retro wrestling fans like Bret Hart, Jake the Snake Roberts, Diamond Dallas Page, and Sergeant Slaughter. Did you know we did a video with him where he gave out Valentine's Day dating advice? Anyway, WrestleQuest is on everything.
Oh, man. The best cologne is the natural cologne.
On the 10th, Atlas Fallen falls onto PC and New Gen, and that is what the studio behind the Surge games has been working on since those came out. It looks a bit like a Monster Hunter-ish kind of thing, but with some Destiny-esque visuals, and it's set against a cool desert backdrop that you can do all sorts of sand skating all over, which, I don't know, that looks like a fun traversal. Still on the 10th is Stray Gods, the role-playing musical, which is exactly what it sounds like. That could go either way, but considering it's from David Gator, the lead writer and narrative designer of Dragon Age, and the music is by Austin Wintory, who scored Journey and the Banner Saga, it has some potential. You know, assuming that musicals aren't a total deal-breaker for you, that's coming to everything. That same day, Stray, the cyberpunk cat game that was formerly PlayStation exclusive, claws its way onto Xbox as well. A few days later, the co-op pixel action RPG Hammerwatch 2 drops. Plenty of players have taken a whack at the original in the decade since its release and deemed it too legit to quit. So hopefully the sequel nails it. You can't touch this until August 15th, but from that point forward, it's hammer time on both the Xboxes and PlayStation, Switch, and PC. You like how I did a little bit of like actual Hammer jokes, but then MC Hammer jokes? Somebody's mad about that in the comments. They say I talk too much. Anyway, on the 16th, PC players can check out On Guard, a game about sword fighting, swashbuckling, and probably cape swishing, you know, that sort of thing. On the 17th, if you like real-time strategy, stealth pirates, and or ghost pirates, say ahoy ahoy to Shadow Gambit, The Cursed Crew, which incorporates all of those things. Meanwhile, if you're a Nintendo Switch owner who's never considered smoking cigarettes, I have great news for you. Vampire Survivors is just as addictive with only some of the carcinogens. This roguelite shmup developed by a bunch of former slot machine designers already hooked PC and Xbox players, and really, putting the full-fledged version on a handheld console is flat-out dangerous and irresponsible. I thought this game looked stupid, but then I tried it, and hoo boy! It's like if you could stick a finger in your ear and just milk your hypothalamus for dopamine release directly. It's so good. And if you're a recovering Vampire Survivors addict looking for a good reason to relapse, a free patch adds four-player co-op. You know what that means? That means that you and three of your friends can sit there in complete silence, drooling and staring glassy-eyed at multiple vortexes of fireballs and daggers and axes and doves and boomerangs and coins and so on, chasing that sublime thrill of opening a treasure chest that has like five of the little things coming out. The game is really fun. On the 18th, Bomb Rush Cyberpunk is a clear-cut homage to Jet Set Radio, and it'll have you blading and boarding all over a gorgeous cel-shaded city, doing graffiti and breakdancing and living up like it's Y2K all over again. That's on Switch and PC. More cel-shaded games, please. They look great and they age well. Also on the 18th is Madden 24, the latest installment in the prolific football franchise that I struggle to say interesting things about year after year in these videos. This game will be one of the best-selling titles of the year no matter what I say, and odds are, if you're the kind of person who plays it, you're already aware of what incremental changes this latest iteration has made over last year's installment, and you've made up your mind about whether or not you plan to purchase a copy. So let's all just sit quietly for a moment while the men run around on the field. There they go, look at them. Anyway, Madden 24 is coming to everything but Switch. Also on the 18th is the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, the latest classic horror movie to get the asymmetrical multiplayer treatment, and this one is from some of the same folks who made Friday the 13th. However, unlike that game's Jason vs. Everyone approach, this one is a 5v5 where one team is a bunch of happening 1970s youths, and the other team gets to play as members of that messed up family, all of whom have different abilities. I love how much they nailed the aesthetic of the original movie. Everybody is gonna wanna be Leatherface, but what are you gonna do? Did you know that this is actually the first Texas Chainsaw Massacre game in 41 years? The last one came out on Atari 2600. The new one is on PS5, Series X, and PC. Leatherface cleans up good. On the 22nd, Immortals of Avium bombards you with Unreal Engine 5 particle effects and lighting and textures and all that good stuff while you bombard enemies with blasts of deadly magic. This is a fast-paced FPS that shakes things up by swapping out the usual mundane military arsenal for some occult abilities that would be right at home in the hands of a certain cape-wearing master of the mystic arts who was formerly a famous surgeon. Can you guess who I'm talking about? He was in a car accident and then he became a superhero. That's on new gen and PC. That very same day, Fort Solace hits PS5 and PC, and I feel like there hasn't been much chatter about this creepy deep space narrative adventure, but it looks nice, and it'll probably sound nice too, because it features the voice talents of the wonderful Roger Clark, who you probably know best as Arthur Morgan in Red Dead Redemption 2, as well as the also wonderful Troy Baker, who you probably know best as literally every other video game character. On the 24th, your prayers have been answered. Blasphemous 2 is back with more cataclysmically hard hack and slash action and some striking imagery that'd likely go over like a fart in church among a more parochial crowd, but hey, it's not like they didn't warn you in the title. That's on new gen, PC, and Switch. Ooh, here's a good one. On the 25th, Armored Core 6 Fires of Rubicon drops as the first installment in From Software's prolific mech combat series in over a decade. Anyone expecting to praise the sun, fear the old blood, or arise tarnished may be sorely disappointed, or maybe pleasantly surprised if they're expecting anything similar to the studio's more recent offerings. And really, it'll be interesting to see how this is received by the Souls camp as well as longtime AC fans. I'm personally just very happy that we're getting some big old robots crashing around up there on the video game machines. That's on the Xboxes, the PlayStations, and the PC. If you prefer dinosaurs to robots, that's totally okay, and you're in luck, because on the 29th, Goodbye Volcano High is a narrative adventure about some adolescent dinosaurs dealing with that daunting end-of-the-world feeling that comes leading up to graduation, which is probably even worse when your entire species teeters on the brink of extinction. Actually, that's probably what current high schoolers feel like. Sorry, kids. Anyway, the colorful and maybe depressing dinosaur game is on the PlayStations and the PC. Still on the 29th is Sea of Stars, a retro-styled turn-based RPG that definitely looks like a retro-styled turn-based RPG, but it's a very pretty one. This is from the studio behind The Messenger, the extremely good retro-styled action platformer that nailed that 8-bit Ninja Gaiden Strider vibe, so hopefully they can do the same thing and give us a solid 16-bit Final Fantasy, Breath of Fire, Chrono Trigger, Phantasy Star, Illusion of Gaia type game. That's on PS4 and Switch and PC. Still on the 29th is Under the Waves, which is yet another narrative adventure set in the deep sea and also the 1970s. You play as a guy named Stan who's coping with grief and also submersibles and probably some scary fish, but mostly grief. So if Diver Dave was too upbeat for you, or you wish that Abzu was upsetting instead of relaxing, or you wish that Subnautica made you contemplate your own mortality more than it made you think about collecting starfish to build a jet ski and avoid getting eaten by a squid or whatever it is you do in that game, here you go. Life is much better down where it's wetter, aside from all the grief, on the PlayStations, Xboxes, and PC. If you'd rather shake your cares away on Nintendo Switch, Samba de Amigo's long-awaited sequel finally hit Switch that very same day, and I feel like this was supposed to be out earlier this year, and then it got delayed, and someone got mad at me for announcing the original date in one of these videos, even though we'd recorded it prior to the announcement. Did that happen? I don't know. Who can keep track? Well, I can, and I'm still mad about it. You turn this Samba de Amigo into a Conga de Enemigos. Also on the 29th is EA Sports FC24, which is what EA is now calling FIFA since the publisher parted ways with the football organization bearing the same name. Don't expect this to be a whole new ball game, though for any Switch fans underwhelmed by the phoned-in FIFA legacy editions of years past, the Switch version of FC24 looks to be more than just a reskin this time around, which is, well, nice, I guess. That's on everything. On the 30th, Daymare 1994 Sandcastle brings more old-school survival horror, heavily inspired by a certain series that rhymes with President Knievel, and as the title suggests, this is a prequel that takes place 4 years before the events of Daymare 1998. That's coming to everything but Switch. If that unironic Steve Zissou grief simulator isn't bleak enough, on the 31st, grab the tissues and probably the morphine because you've got your work cut out for you in War Hospital, a 3D isometric RTS that has you leading the medical corps instead of soldiers during World War I, which seems like even more war of attrition than the actual trench variety. That's on PC, PS5, and Series X. As of recording this video, Phasmophobia's new gen and PSVR2 versions do not have a solid date, and I'm sure they're going to announce a date 20 minutes after this video is done exporting, because that's usually how it goes. Anyway, huge thank you to everybody who left nice comments on last month's video. As you can see, I took your advice and I bought the stupid cat shirt, and I'm sad to report that this just made Instagram advertise the same shirt to me even more, because that's how the algorithms work, apparently. You're just cursed. It's just gonna live with me. It's like herpes, but it's a Junji Ito cat t-shirt. Anyway, let me know what you're playing this month. I'm still glued to Zelda, but maybe I'll get fed up with trying to build a mech out of logs and ceiling fans and trampolines and just play Armored Core instead. And then go build Gundam models, because that's too hard, because I have the reflexes and manual dexterity of a prize-winning sow with a trough full of cooking sherry. And on that note, I'll see you next month.